morning and welcome to St. Jacob Lutheran Church.
Good morning.
We're so glad that you are here today. Today we rejoice over what God has done by sending His Son into our world to save us. We begin by singing our opening hymn, Let All Together Praise Our God. That's pages 1 and 2 in your worship folder and on the screen. Our human nature, by his gracious coming, deliver us from the corruption of our sin and transform us into the likeness of his glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Isaiah 45, reading verses 20 through 25. Unless there is any doubt, God says here, that there is no God beside him, no one righteous, no one who is God and Savior above all. And I think personally that is shown in the Christmas season. Huh? Who could do such marvelous things? Who could do such great and wondrous things to send his one and only Son to be born into our world? Gather. Come, draw near together, you survivors from the nations. They have no knowledge, those who are lifting up their idols of wood and praying to a God that cannot save. Make an announcement and come close. Let them consult together. Who made this known ahead of time? From time past, who announced it? Was it not I, the Lord? There is no God except me, a righteous God and Savior. There is no one except me. Turn to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, because I am God and there is no other. I have sworn by myself, from my mouth a righteous word has gone out, and it will not return unfulfilled. Indeed, to me every knee will bow, and every tongue will swear allegiance. Only in the Lord will they say of me. Only in the Lord is there true righteousness and strength. To him they will come and be ashamed, all those who are angry at him. In the Lord, all the descendants of Israel will be justified. They will be praised by him. This is the word of the Lord. I invite you to sing Psalm 111. That's on page 3 and also on the screen. Listen to the organist as she plays the song, the psalm tone and the refrain at the beginning. Verses 12 through 17. Paul says here to the Colossians and us that we are to act in a certain way because we are God's chosen people. As God's elect, there are certain things that should be noticeable in our life. Forgiveness and love and the God's word being used often in our life. You read about those things in Colossians 3. Therefore, as God's elect, holy and loved, clothe yourselves with heartfelt compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with one another and forgive each other if one has a complaint against anyone else. Forgive just as Christ forgave you. And in addition to all these things, put on love, which ties things together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ control your hearts, to which you were also called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And everything you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the epistle of our Lord. Alleluia, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Alleluia. Thank you. Savior has been born for us. Our text is Luke chapter 2, reading verses 10 and 11, and then verse 20. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all people. Today in the town of David a Savior has been born for you. He is Christ the Lord." And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Peace to all of you who are in Christ Jesus. 1 Peter 5:14. Dear friends in Christ, obviously Christmas is a time to celebrate. The world does not hesitate to help you with that so that you can feast, sing, play, drink, and host many parties. But it will work doubly hard to keep you, keep Christ from spoiling Christmas, if you would, and the celebration, and support efforts to help separate church and state, church and business, church and school, and church and family. They do not want any religious influence in the celebration. In their view, what's Christ got to do with Christmas? Well, everything, actually. Jesus is the reason for the season. Christians celebrate, and the world celebrates this holiday because God sent his Son to be born into the world of a virgin. Christ is in the name Christmas, because originally the Roman Catholic Church called it Christ Mass, which is the worship of Christ. Repeated quickly, it becomes Christ Mass Praise Christmas. You can see how that flows together. Should a child of God then fight the world and its ways and discover that in our faith, not in laws or ordinances, that there is victory that overcomes the world, our faith? We recognize there will be persecution, but we turn the other cheek, carry on, train our family, find strength in the Lord, serve wherever we can, attend our gatherings, and support the causes that promote the teachings of our Lord. So today we look at the theme, Prepare the Way, Rejoicing in the Way. The world cannot celebrate something it does not understand. They have eyes but do not see. They have ears but do not hear. They have minds but do not see. Jesus said, "You have mind, you have eyes but do not see. You have ears, do you not hear? Do you not remember?" Spiritual matters can only be understood by spiritual people. What we receive is not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, so that we might know the blessings freely given to us by God. To enrich ourselves in the spirit, to seek our own hearts by the power of the spirit, to find strength in the word and sacrament, to praise God for his gifts of grace, to pray that he would give us the strength to all who know him, to pray for those who do not know him, and to ask God to use us in his way to bring our hope, the hope that we have in Christ, to others, and always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that is within you. God's people rejoice to know the way in Christ. The book of Acts relates great effort to proclaim Christ coming in the flesh. It refers to the Christian faith as the way. A slave girl followed Paul and kept crying out, "These men are servants of the Most High God, who are proclaiming the way to be saved." And Paul declared this to the Roman governor Felix, "But I do confess to you that I worship the God of our fathers according to the way." Christians recognize that the death and resurrection of Jesus as the way to obtain forgiveness of sins and the way to inherit eternal life for the whole world through the Messiah. Normally, when we use the word way, it has different meanings. It could be a road, like the way to Bethlehem, or a highway through the desert for travelers or exiles to come home, or the road back to God, such as the prodigal son took by requiring repentance and forgiveness. in references to the spiritual path, Jesus called himself the way, stating, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Mary and Joseph's trip to Nazareth from Nazareth to Bethlehem was neither easy nor joyful, for Mary was pregnant, and the approximately 100-mile trip took place during the national census, when most families were required to return to their ancestral hometown. Many pilgrims were therefore on the way, on the roads. There were also many Roman soldiers. In the comparatively small province of Syria, there were 4 legions, or more than 10,000 soldiers, policing Syria, Lebanon, and Palestine, because this was Rome's number one trouble spot. The unrest and the political state atmosphere made the trip uncomfortable. The pious Jews nearing Jerusalem thought of another trip, one that took place more than 1,000 years ago. Jacob and his family were returning to settle in Canaan, and after giving birth to Benjamin, her husband Jacob's baby, Rachel died. Jacob never forgot that, and he commented on it as he was dying in Egypt. Many centuries later, when the Babylonians conquered Palestine and carried thousands back into slavery, thousands of young people, in their grief, people said that in her grave, Rachel is weeping for her children, who refuses to be comforted for her children because they are no more. Matthew, a Jew writing for Jews, heard Rachel's voice once more when Herod slaughtered the innocent boys in Bethlehem. Now Rachel's descendants, as well as Jacob's, were being numbered by the Roman census. Rome wanted to know how many soldiers it required to control the area and if taxes should be increased. Neither Rome nor Palestine knew that traveling to Bethlehem in those days was the Almighty Lord himself, who came to destroy all the works of the devil and save everyone, whether Jew, Babylonian, or Roman. For all of us, there are dangers, emergencies, viruses. We know that all too well. The unknown, the unrest, upsetting situations, and enemies lurking behind turns in our way of life. It is an inner joy, which none can take from us, to know that God is at hand. God is omnipotent, that is all-powerful, and he is in control. God guides all the situations of life. As Paul told the Romans, we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God. By God's grace, we know the way in Christ. We do not know what lies ahead on our path of life, but we need to ask only if we know Christ the way. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is on the path we walk. He is by our side, and he has prepared the way ahead of us. To find lodging in Little Bethlehem had always been a problem, but now it was in utter confusion. Those who had left the family homestead during the previous 10 years to seek work and fortune were coming home. The town was overrun with pilgrims. There was little room for travelers. The place where the animals were fed was the only shelter available. The Lord, whom the heavens cannot contain, was laid in a manger. In truth, the heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you. The Lord, the Word, made flesh and dwelt among us, and he was laid in a feeding trough. But God provides, perhaps not always the way we prefer. If we have prayed and this is what he provides, then that is what is under his care and on his way. God has gone ahead and seen to it, and something is there. A little with God is far better than much without him. Proverbs says, better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. In other words, it is better to have soup with herbs and eat it in peace with God and among friends than to have a feast and eat in bitterness and hatred. Paul also advised Timothy, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For he brought nothing into the world, and we certainly cannot take anything out of it. Often the poor of this world know God's care more than the wealthy. But whether wealthy or poor, God is to be praised, and those who know him and his care do just that. The child was born, of whom Mary wondered how he would be conceived. The boy was born to Joseph, who was to name Jesus, give him the name Jesus, because he would save people from their sins. But he was also the one who made Joseph wonder whether or not to continue with the marriage. Both Mary and Joseph meditated, trusted, and relied on the promises of God. Both rejoiced in the news that the shepherds shared with them about the angel's message. When the way gets rough with doubt and bewilderment, and when the unknown becomes unbearable, when we wonder if there is anything, any way to resolve our difficulty, how good to know and rejoice that we know the way in Christ. Joseph and Mary trusted and supported each other, for when Christ literally and spiritually was in their midst, they had a presence and a power which is also ours, to keep together with God and with one another. The home centers around him. As the psalmist says, if the Lord does not build the house, it is useless for the builders to work hard over it. The presence of God, what a joy to know him. Christ invested himself in our nature. He took on our humanity and was born of a virgin. He willingly humbled himself as a servant and took our place. He died for all, even for the ungodly. As Paul said to the Romans, for at the time, appointed time, while we were still helpless, Christ died for the ungodly. But God shows his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God's people celebrate that we know Jesus and pray that people will find joy through him. Our joy today is more than Mary had in a safe delivery, or that a baby was born. Our Lord once commanded, a woman giving birth has pain because her time has come. But when she has delivered the child, she no longer remembers the anguish because of her joy that a person has been born into the world. Joy comes with the birth of a child. The fruit of the womb is God's reward. But this was more. This was extraordinary. There were heavenly messengers from God. There was a message of hope, of peace, of salvation, of forgiveness, which could not come but from heaven itself. When hearing it without hesitating, the shepherds went to Bethlehem. This was the birth of the Messiah, the Savior of the world. This was the Christ, the Anointed One, the Promised One. This was not only a boy or a man, but the Lord himself. The Lord had clothed himself in the vesture of humanity. The infinite came as an infant. He who is spirit came in flesh. To know Jesus is to know eternal life and the way to it. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. To know Jesus is to know the Father and the way to him. To know him is to be able to come into the very presence of the Holy One, the Creator, the Sustainer of the world, and all that there is beyond this world. To know Jesus is to be convinced that he will keep our life committed to him until the day of judgment. But I am not ashamed, because I know the one in whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. Such knowledge gives hope and joy, which God freely and willingly shares with us as pilgrims, travelers on life's way, who need rest from our restlessness, faith when our faith falls short, hope when all is in despair, light when all seems gloom, and confidence when doubts jump from the hidden corners of our heart, demanding answers. God in Christ comes to us, who are weary and worn, tired and tried, sinning and making mistakes, forgiving all our sins, so we can lift up our heads and rejoice with the shepherds and Mary, Joseph, and the wise men. Will it ever be that we find joy along the journey of life? Yes. Jesus Christ, our Savior, came. It happened. Some have lost that joy, as Jesus said, because of persecution or troubles. And as the seed could not put down deep roots, the joy was lost. Some have lost that joy because, like the rich young ruler, they wanted to follow him but left all in sorrow, for they have great wealth or other loves. For those, we pray that someday they can celebrate with us in knowing Jesus. This joy God wants us to have, the joy in knowing God forgives our sin, in knowing that he casts no one aside, and in knowing that he has completely saved us. When the shepherds had seen the Savior, who is Christ the Lord, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. As we celebrate knowing this child, our Savior, we too share with those who don't yet know him. Amen. May the peace that surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. We stand and we'll say together the Apostles' Creed. It's found on page 5 in your worship folder if you are on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, that your advent or coming as our Savior was foretold by men of old. We believe that in your lowly birth of the Virgin Mary, the scriptures have been fulfilled, and that you, the very Son of God, through whom all things were created, assumed human form. We believe that you came here in lowliness as the Lamb of God to bear our sins in your own body on the cross and to suffer and die there for us. Is not this a wonder that earth played host to her Creator, and that you who are eternal were born a tiny infant? Is not this a wonder that you who are rich with all the fullness of power and majesty as God became poor, that through the poverty of your humiliation you might make us everlastingly rich? O Jesus, Son of God and Savior of mankind, who you are and what you did on our behalf fills us with holy awe and wonder and deserves our continual praise. When aged Simeon held you in his arms, he recognized you with great joy as the long-awaited Savior, the light of the Gentiles, and the glory of Israel. Filled with peace and joy, he was ready to depart this life and heir of heaven, saved by grace through faith. Like Simeon of old, we too rejoice to know you as our Savior from sin. Establish our hearts forever in the truth that your perfect sacrifice has purchased pardon and peace from God for us. Keep us ready at all times to depart this life with joy, confident in the assurance that you have redeemed us with your precious blood. We ask for all this in Jesus' name. Amen. We join together in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated. sing hymn 78. all of you. To any guests, we ask you to sign the guest book in the entryway and please come and worship with us again. Pastor and Karen will be leaving today for a few days to visit my family. We'll come back on the 30th, God willing, and that in time for our New Year's Eve service on the 31st at 7 p.m. We'll look forward, we'll reflect on the past year and look forward to God's blessings in the new year. The flowers on the altar have been given by Marilyn Fleiss. Well, some of them, anyway. Others of them have been given by members, but for the glory of God, we thank you for that. I don't have too much else. I was wondering about the flowers, about taking them home today.
Yes, they can take them home.
If you want. We'll have the Wells connection here if there are no other announcements.
We're still looking for a January donator of flowers. If you feel like it, please see me today or next Sunday, because I probably won't get them filled for next Sunday because we still have plenty of poinsettias.
And technically, it's still Christmas.
Yeah.